Welcome, George.
Hey, how's it going?
So good, so good.
Good. I'm just finishing off some dinner, so I'll be like silent for the next 5 minutes.
Yeah, for sure. Bon appétit.
Hey guys.
Hi Bogdan. All right, let's get started. So I'll share my screen and on the agenda. Welcome everyone. This is October 5th, 2023, Ares V6 community call, and Hyperledger antitrust policy is in effect as displayed on the screen. We have agenda prepared for today. I think there might be some discussions about ongoing PRs and stuff like that. So, wait, today is not October 5th. So apologies, this is off page, obviously. It's October 12th. So that was a bad intro for anybody's watching this in the recording. Might be confusing. Anyway, so let me try again. So welcome to October 12th, 2023, Ares V6 community call. And let's see our agenda. I haven't attended any community meetings myself this week. I'm not sure if there was any since there's IIW conference going on, which probably is also people over there right now. Do you guys have any kind of news you gathered or overheard over the past week, or attended any calls?
I think there was news about AFJ potentially moving to the Open Wallet Foundation.
Oh yeah, that did happen. I don't know if it's yet finalized. I saw the proposal and lots of people voting for that, but haven't watched the how it's playing out recently. I guess they go forward with that. Do you know, George?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I just heard mention of it.
Yeah, that is going on. So one of the things. Yeah, other than that, I guess then we can move forward. If there's nothing else to share, mentorship updates. Well, we have a 9 on the call. I9, do you want to give a short briefing as what you're up to recently and how it's going?
Sure. So there's a PM currently that submits some initial work on the mediator. It exposes on the mediator coordination side. Supporting the mediator coordination protocol. The work is almost in a day or two. You might see the PR, an agent will be able to register on the mediator and do stuff with its keys, like register the keys it wants forward messages to be addressed for and such.
Right. Actually,
so this part is like I've done the code.
And is anybody else having
yes,
like connection issues?
Yeah.
Nan, you kind of
drop it.
I think your connection is having some issues because lots of your speech
actually
was dropped off.
Okay, sorry about that. Am I audible now?
Yeah. Do you think, is there anything you can do with your connection? Maybe different Wi-Fi or, I don't know, any actions you can take? Because it sounds like it's not stable. Now.
How about now?
No, it's good so far. Maybe we can give it a shot if you change something.
All right. So yeah, I changed the position. So hopefully it should be a stronger connection now.
Yeah, maybe.
Yes, so the current PR is there, and right now, over this week, I have worked on mediator coordination protocol support in the mediator agent. So that is hooking into the previous work and supporting mediator coordination messages through the Aries agent. So that's being currently done. I haven't submitted the PR for that yet. This PR is going to be updated with those features. Mm-hmm. Today or tomorrow. Right now I'm writing the tests for the same. So once I have the test written, I'll update this PR with that.
Awesome. So I guess you're more focused now on like kind of moved from the kind of manual terminal UI based testing to more automated approach, right?
Yes. Yes, nice. We have moved from that to automated testing. Yes. Cool. This one already has some automated tests. And the update will have tests for mediator coordination protocol support.
Sweet. That sounds great. Looking forward. Exciting. Nice. Thank you. Thank you for that. Well, we don't have Swapnil. George, do you want to give any update on Swapnil's behalf?
Yeah, so Swapnil put up a PR for the whole day API work, but still in draft phase. Missing the Unify exposure. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Swapnil is on it this week. And yeah, hopefully a good update by next week.
Cool. All right. Thank you. Let's see, what do we have next? So overview. Didn't have much work merged in the past week. There was this refactoring, changing trade objects in favor of generics. So that was merged. We didn't have the approval from you, George. Have you just checking? Have you have chance to see these, or are you okay with those changes we have done here?
Yeah, was this merged in last week's meeting or before that?
I think it was in progress, and I think it was merged soon after the meeting. I guess maybe
earlier. Oh, sorry. Yeah,
in the last week.
This is in libvcx. I'm thinking of the changes in Aries VCX.
Right.
Yeah, no. It impacts you that much. You don't use this, do you?
Yeah, no. So, yeah.
Right.
Not too much concern for me.
Okay. Right. Oh, yeah, right. It's mostly V6 core. Okay. So, yeah, then I guess moving on to more discussion worthy stuff, more interesting things, is the PR, which is in progress, deletion of VDR tools, which has a green light from me and from Mira as well. But I saw George. Ah, okay. I see that you give your approval now. So how things are looking here? I guess it is looking green now.
Yeah, everything should be in order now. George spotted some compilation issues when no features were enabled, which I thought was going to get caught by the workspace-wide Clippy CI job, but apparently it wasn't. So I added another job to kind of basically cover that case as well. And in fact, I left a comment somewhere on one of the conversations that perhaps down the road, especially after a better separation is done. I think George resolved that, but nevertheless, I'll summarize. So, you know, like part of the plan is to also kind of separate test code from proper, let's say, production Aries VCX code. And as a result of that, we could perhaps make Aries VCX not have any sort of default features and instead be, you know, enabled manually by consumers if they need or want to. But right now, I'm not sure if such a change would be possible or easy to do, because there are all these tests and the way they work, and they might rely on the default features being enabled, so disabling that might create some mayhem, which I don't really want to deal with. So I think the better approach would maybe be to do that separation of test code and production code, and then the tweaking the feature flag should probably be much easier based on that. Yeah, so there's that. And then that job, that CI job, just for, Aries VCX without any sort of features won't be required anymore, because without any sort of default features, it's just going to get caught by the workspace wide Clippy job. Yeah, so that was that.
Right.
I don't remember if there's anything else in particular. There was something about some feature flags on the sovereign bid resolver that George caught. So that was also handled. And he also had some questions about, yeah, this is about the DIDSOV resolver. And then the one above that's still unresolved, it's mainly just an open question that George asked about the VDR proxy profile. But I'm not necessarily too versed with that implementation to be able to tell something. I just replaced the VDR tools components with the Credex ones mainly, and tweak the feature flags accordingly.
I didn't have a chance to see this, so I'll just read it quickly. A general question doesn't need to be answered here. Does VDR proxy ledger, where VDR proxy submitter is the core component, actually need the Credex feature? Guys know this part of the code the best, but it seems like the only reason VDR proxy ledger needs Credex is because VDR proxy ledger is being used to hide the VDR proxy profile implementation, which depends on in the Credex on Credex. I wonder if logically VDR proxy profile should be hidden by Credex and VDR proxy ledger rather than making VDR proxy ledger always depend on Credex. Yeah, it does sound like I don't think VDR proxy submitter needs to necessarily depend on Credex. So I think there is a space for improvement.
Well, yeah, but just want to point out that this used to be like this before. It just didn't depend on Credex. It depended on...
Well,
actually, it depended on Credex, in fact, from what I can see. So I wouldn't necessarily solve this within this PR.
Absolutely. I mean, just the VDR, the ledger client in general should not need the anon credits component, right? It just it's transactions. So whether it's Credex or VDR tools, it shouldn't need either of them. But yeah, I agree. It's not the scope of this PR. So yeah, we can get it addressed later.
Feel free to resolve that. Just wanted to raise it.
Yep. Good catch. And I guess given your approval, I think we can now go ahead and get it merged. So I'll do that after the call.
Cool. Just a general question about testing the feature flag variants. I understand that they're sort of transitively being tested and asserted through the Clippy test. But do you think it'd be valuable, not in this PR, but maybe in another PR, to put back in the CI job to test all the different variants of different feature flags?
This is still being done. The thing is that it used to be done through cargo check, and we would have, like, as part of the linting and the lint removal, I introduced these Clippy jobs. The thing is that they do the same thing, only that Clippy will also look for lints. So if something builds with cargo check, it will build with Clippy. Or maybe put it the other way around. If something builds with Clippy, like cargo Clippy, it's going to build with cargo check too. So it's not really helpful to have both of them. It's just that this use case I just missed. Previously, the cargo check job had all these variants like hard coded in with the features. Now it's a matrix CI job that will run combinations of features. But there was none indeed that would just disable all of them. And there's a workspace-wide Clippy job that will basically test all the crates, but because of those default features, it doesn't really handle like no feature at all. So that's practically why it happened. I agree that this could probably be done in a better fashion, but I think the proper way to go would maybe to remove those default features, and rather depend on them as needed, and this should make it also easier to test CI wise what's going on.
Okay, cool. Well, yeah, I was just sort of thinking, like, I guess testing all the different combinations of feature flags together and lack of feature flags isn't really the sort of job of that Clippy check. It's just so happens that it's also doing it in the background, right? So I don't know if it should be its own explicit thing so that its purpose is obvious rather than just being implicitly done.
Well, the thing is that it's not necessarily implicitly done. The idea is that you would also want to have lint checking on all these possible combination flags because, like feature flags, because you know, especially with how intertwined they are right now, and I know you could disable the VDR tools wallet and use something else instead and just enable Credex, or maybe the other way around. So you could have lints that only appear when a feature is enabled or disabled, or a combination of features is enabled or disabled. So it's also looking for that while also basically compiling the code and doing that. There's no other way to do it, so it will compile the code.
Right.
It's just that the checking for lints will have an overhead, obviously, compared to just doing the build, which is what cargo check does. But if you introduce both of them, the cargo check one is just redundant. So,
yep. Okay, that's cool. Fair enough.
And personally, like, I use Rust Analyzer and VS Code, and I don't even use cargo check. I replace the command for checking the code with Clippy. I'd rather use Clippy and have the lints also available at all times so that I can see what's going on. You know, but that's just a personal preference. I'm just saying that we're not losing anything. This was just a snafu on my part, if you will. Just messed it up because of the CI jobs replacement. And the thing is that I did test this out. I also pointed out in the comment, like, I thought that running Cargo Clippy with no default features workspace-wise is actually going to catch this, but apparently it doesn't. So that's where I got confused. I thought this scenario is actually covered, but it wasn't. So yeah, you have to run it specifically on Aries VCX. Pretty much like how cargo check was being run before. So there's no difference necessarily between the tools.
Cool. Okay. Thanks for explaining. Makes sense.
Yep.
All right. Going forward in the agenda, we had the review that was quickly sorted. Another one in progress. So the V2 issuance presentation protocols, the issuance PR for now, that has been reviewed somewhat, I think, by both of us at this point, in Bogdan. And we'll have some comments. I still wanted to go actually deeper, but nevertheless, I left a number of comments and didn't get to re-review it again or read the replies or kind of catch up with what's going on. Well, there's not many replies yet. But yeah, so I was wondering what's... Bogdan left a big comment here. There's discussion going on. So I don't know. There's a space to kind of, I guess... hear your thoughts, George, on all the comments we left so far collectively, and perhaps any discussion, continuing discussion, which seems to be going on here between you and Bogdan.
This is going to be a somewhat longer discussion, so brace yourselves. just putting it there, but I think it's going to be productive.
We could leave it to the end if you wanted. I'm sorry for interrupting, but yeah, we could leave it to the end.
That's what I wanted to say. Maybe I think it's a good idea, George. Maybe if we leave it towards the end, so we have a lot of room to.
All right. I believe it's almost the end. So I guess just the last thing to note after this is they'll be doing the release 060, which will have after the VDR tools removal is merged. We'll be doing the 060 release. And by the way, also, yes, as you guys are probably aware, George as well, but perhaps a heads up for Nyan. Once this PR is merged, which should be in an hour or so, this also upgrades the SQLX version, SQLX dependency. So now you can also upgrade your SQLX to 0.7.1, I believe we are using here. So you can get the upgrade there. And yeah, that will be follow up with 0.6.2 release, and hopefully we'll be also able to add in ASCAR implementation without much dependency conflict. I'll see about that. Something I wanted to get started, but didn't manage to get to that yet. Not much, to say the least. This is a DPR 4 implementation, which then will unlock us kind of experimentation trying to implement DITCOM V2. So that's planned. And we have some admitting discussion points here added. So as a question, how does the life cycle of Aries connection end? When is it okay to forget a peer? And a few points. A server over time may end up with many connections that it stores encryption keys for that have completed their purpose. What is the process to terminate and forget these connections? And how will peer know it has been forgotten and needs to establish new connection? So I take it that this is from you, Naim.
Yes, that's from me. While working on the registration, the mediator coordination request, so this came up.
Good question.
Many flyby connections. So how do you know which one to store and for how long?
Good questions. So you at today's state of art, you don't know. I'm not aware of protocol to tell your peer, to announce your peer that they have been forgotten. I guess it kind of depends on individual agent approach. Perhaps if you ping your peer and they don't ping you back, whatever your policy is, you might consider that connection as abandoned and deleted. Obviously, that can then cause that, in fact, the counterpart didn't forget the connection. They've just been offline for a long period of time, and then they come back and they get no response. But even in such a case, I guess the agent should have a strat. When the forgotten agent wakes up and they try to reach you, they try to ping you, don't reply back, then they might as well have their own policy, I don't get a reply, I need to talk to this person, let me just reestablish connection, again, and perhaps delete the old pair of keys themselves as well. So it's kind of something for now. I don't think this was addressed on community, level with some sort of standard protocol to do this. What is the process to so that's also answers this, that there's none I'm aware of. That's kind of, I guess I kind of address all of these points. So it's kind of application level for now. Maybe for your case of the mediator, it's even more problematic because as a mediator, you are not able to ping your counterparties typically, as they don't have any endpoint themselves. They just talk to you. So again, it comes down, comes down to your implementation, where perhaps you could also have a timeout if a client doesn't connect, for a year. You forget him, but then there might be problems what if he has unprocessed messages? Do you delete those as well or not? What do you do? But I think you can just, I think in your case, I wouldn't worry about it at this point. You can just kind of perpetually accumulate them. And, the database having, a million entries in their database shouldn't necessarily be a problem. And probably given current state of adoption, this won't be practical of Aries. It shouldn't be yet really a problem. even if you have million peers, it's not that much, you know, in index database. And you probably will not have million peers. And by the time this becomes a problem, I'm sure it is going to be addressed on kind of a ecosystem, you know, ecosystem wide level.
Right. Yes. So the main problem that, I mean, the way in which this arises is the flyby connections. For example, someone is dropping a forward message for someone that is registered on the mediator.
Mm-hmm.
Then these third parties who are dropping messages, they'll have to establish a connection, of course, with the mediator communicate with the mediator.
So actually, okay, so I see where then. Okay, so there's a misconception. They don't need to, you know, in order to send a message, you know, in order to drop off a message in the mediator, you don't need to establish connection. You just drop in, send a DITCOM message. Send a DITCOM message. Encrypted for the target, you know, key held by, you know, controlled by the entity you are sending a message to. You drop off such a message in a basically a forward message in a mediator, and mediator takes that, process it, stores it on behalf of the recipient. And
the forward message is going to be inside an ADS envelope, right?
Yes.
And so for that envelope, you can either do auth crypt or anencrypt. So I'm assuming you're saying that they will anencrypt the message to the mediator. Even in that case, they need the keys for the mediator, right? So they'll have to go to the out of band invitation endpoint and then receive that message and then try to connect to the mediator to receive the mediator's encryption keys.
Okay, I see. Well, the bottom line is, you have a point. You probably want to do anencrypt. You don't want to like pass in the plain. Ideally, you don't want to pass in the plain forward message, even though it's encrypted. But the bottom line is, you don't have these parties which are simply dropping off message for someone. They don't have to connection protocol with the mediator itself. They don't.
Do you know encryption keys to wrap it with? The encryption envelope, like what will be the keys used for that? So right now it's being transferred through the connection protocol, right?
Well, they simply, you see, when you have two parties, let's say me and you, we want to establish a risk connection, right? And you are using the mediator, you know, you have the mediator implementation, you know, you're using, and you give me, now you want to connect with me through DITCOM. So you generate also invitation for me. You pass that to me, you know, over you know, you send me a QR code by some messenger or whatever trusted communication channel we already have.
Yes.
So you give me an invitation, and in that invitation, there's going to be a couple pieces of information. It's going to be URL endpoints into your mediator. Yeah. It's going to be
and routing key.
Recipient key and the routing key. So now I'm going to send you some sort of reply, you know, on your invitation. I guess I'm going to send you connection request, because that's what you typically do when you get the invitation. So I want to send you connection request message. And what I'm going to do is, first, I'm going to encrypt that with the recipient key. That's the like, bottom layer encryption. And then I'll just wrap it with the routing keys specified in that invitation. As many routing keys as there is, that many times I'm going to wrap it up. Those routing keys, those can be possibly the, those would be the key you registered in the mediator. I can do an encrypt on those keys and just send it to the agents, to the mediator. There's, you know, no further connections needed. That's the encryption layer. You know, the top encryption layer will be using the routing keys you gave me, and those keys. Wait. Okay.
So the mediator's endpoint Aries connection is going to be one of the routing keys that Alice sends in her connection to Bob, sort of.
So basically the routing keys, you see the private portion of those routing keys, that's something that might or might not be, well, those would be typically generated and reside on the mediator, actually. So let me have a brief look at the what is the coordination protocol?
Yes.
Aries coordination protocol, RFC. That will be this one. I believe when you're registering the key, you get a reply back. So when you're requesting mediation, right? It gives you back routing key. So this is a key which would be, this is a key generated by the mediator, and it's given to you as a client. So this is the routing key then you would be, you know, using in the invitation you generate with other people if you instruct them to, you know, talk to you over the mediator. Then you would include the mediator URL, but also the mediator's, the routing key that mediator gave you to use. So then when the car, when me, as I want to reply to your invitation, I'm gonna send you the message. I encrypt with your recipient keys, but then I'm also gonna use AuthCrypt to grab the message, encrypted using these routing keys and send that to the mediator.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense. So I assume that these routing keys are the mediator's own routing keys, as in the mediator is going to have another mediator. But this seems to be the mediator's own key that it'll use to receive messages.
Correct. And, you know, I suppose you, like, in the initial, I'm not sure if you have implemented this, but you don't necessarily have to implement this in a first version. Maybe you can technically get by with returning empty key, and basically then you as a mediator client wanting to connect with me, another person, you would just give me your recipient key and the agent, you know, and your mediator URL. You wouldn't give me a routing key. That makes things a bit less secure, obviously, but standard wise it should still work. The mediator will still see the forward message I'm sending you, and it should still be able to store that message on your behalf and then let you download it. So this is something additional. You probably should implement, but don't necessarily have to in order to make things work initially.
Right. Yeah, so I'm having a bit of a hard time understanding how it's going to happen without the key, but I think I can implement it with the keys. I mean, that's already there.
Mm. We can talk about it perhaps on tomorrow's
yes.
Kind of stand-up session.
We should talk about tomorrow. Yes.
All right.
So right now, I'll be just going forward with passing the mediator's key inside this routing keys vector.
Yeah, could be. That should work too. All right, so let's finish this on tomorrow's technical session, and let's take a step back for the V2 issuance presentation protocols. I have 20 minutes, so let's see what we can cover. So I don't know, George, do you want to say some initial words about, I don't know, given the feedback which was given to you from both me and Bogdan, what's your thoughts?
I was gonna try resolve some of your comments, Patrick, but I was sort of anticipating that there might be a request for a more foundational change to the work, which is what Bogdan is proposed. And you know, Bogdan states a good case. I'm not sure if you've had a time to read it. Have you had time to read it yet, Patrick?
Unfortunately, I have not.
Okay, all good.
We can summarize the ideas here and take it from there.
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay, yeah, so I'll just summarize my perception of things. So I guess it all boils down to how these formats things are being handled and processed and introduced. I think that they do too much right now with the current implementation. And that they're too intertwined with the protocol itself, or the state machine, or just the inner workings of the protocol. So ultimately, these attachments are just represent, not these attachments, these formats, sorry, these formats are representations of the attachment, right, that comes with one of the messages in this protocol, and maybe also in present proof V2 that's also going to most likely use it. And I've been thinking about, and I've been reading through specifications and whatnot in RFCs, and I've been thinking about what are these formats really used for. And my point of view is that the protocol itself, and I'm strictly talking about the protocol does not care what format you're sending your attachments in, or it doesn't even care, I guess, even if you change formats on the fly. What it really boils down to is if you decide to use a specific format, let's say the AGL Indy, so the Hyperledger Indy, this is practically the traditional format that credentials have right now in V1. If you decide to use that, the only thing that matters, or the only thing that this is really important for, is how you're actually going to process these messages and these attachments, and implicitly the stuff that you get of the attachment, whether it's a credential definition or not credential definition, whether it's a credential or some proof presentation or whatever. And these things end up being used in, I'm just going to say anon creds for the sake of brevity, but George made a very good point, and I didn't include that because I thought it might confuse things. But right now there are all these, I don't know, verifiable credentials implementations out there. So there's the Indy Credex, and then there's anon creds that branched from that, and they're very, very similar. And then there's the W3C stuff, and apparently there's also something from the Identity Foundation now. And when I say anon creds right now, I'm merely referring to the mechanisms through which these verifiable credentials are created, verified, proven. You know, that's what I really mean. And I'm just going to say anon creds because otherwise I don't really have a good name for that. So maybe that will also clear something regarding what I was saying and what you responded to, George, in terms of anon creds. So yeah, that's that. So what I wanted to say is that, again, let's say anon creds, the format is really tied to however you're going to be processing these credentials. So if you use Credex and you want to use the Hyperledger Indy format, they go hand in hand. They were designed for each other. There's also anon creds, the anon creds format, and then the anon creds RS implementation of anon creds, or the anon creds V1 specification. These also go hand in hand. And there's the caveat here that with Anand credits being derived from indie, there's a lot of commonalities. But maybe I should get back to this later. So then there's also like the W3C format. I don't remember what it's called here. I think they just call it Aries, which is weird, but anyway. And that gets processed in a completely different manner. I didn't go through the entire specification of the W3C verifiable credentials, but I saw that there are some controllers being involved. They have a different process. And that would also fall on, in this discussion, that would also fall under the umbrella of AnonCreds, because again, I don't have a better name. If you do, for something that, I don't know, credential handler or something like that, some mechanism to process these things. If you have a better name, I'm all ears.
Sorry, just to interject. Are you suggesting that like the AnonCreds trait could handle the W3C stuff?
Yeah, I'm rather suggesting that we should have something else in terms, you know, like let's say credential handler, and that would come with, we would implement that for credex and indie credentials, and then there would be an implementation for AnonCreds and AnonCreds credentials, and then maybe, you know, an implementation for the W3C credentials and whatever mechanism is there to handle these things for these controllers or whatever. And the reason for that is that an interface like that would actually allow you to make use of these formats, you know. But we're kind of digressing here. Let's get back to this later. So I wanted to start from the fact that the format, like if you receive a message with a credential that's in some JSON-LD format, so some W3C format, you're not going to be able to process that with credex or with AnonCreds, because it's meant to be used, it's sort of tightly coupled to some credential handler implementation, the controller is being used in AnonCreds. If you receive something as a Hyperledger indie credential, I feel like it's technically meant to be used with credex, and conversely, if you receive something, an AnonCreds credential, it's technically meant to be used with the AnonCreds implementation, like the AnonCreds V1 specification. And while you pointed out that these are very similar and AnonCreds can actually handle indie credentials, I think you're also only viewing this through the eyes of a holder, George. When you responded, you mentioned that there might be a preference to actually be able to handle that. And what I'm suggesting is not necessarily not being able to handle that, but rather couple an implementation of credential handling with a format. Whether you choose to use as your implementation the AnonCreds RS library, because you can get away with it, that's up to you. But I feel like these formats were specifically introduced because they realized there's not 100% backwards compatibility between AnonCreds RS and indie credex. And I think this is their kind of getaway card of, we're not necessarily getaway card, but this is basically the design that they came up with to be able to support all of these things in the protocol. So especially when you consider revocation and stuff like that, maybe even issuance of protocols, or issuance of credentials, sorry, then the discrepancies between AnonCreds and indie credex start showing up. So what I'm ultimately trying to get at is, in the protocol, you receive a message, you have the attachment, and it's going to have one or multiple formats. And I mentioned in the comment here that as an agent, what you might want to do is, and I think George agrees with that, you might either have maybe a preferred implementation that you, or a preferred format that you want to look for. And I think George made a very good point about the differences between AnonCreds and W3C credentials, in that the W3C ones are a little less secure, or I don't, they don't obfuscate as much stuff, whereas Anon creds are more private and more focused on privacy. So depending on your use, you might just want to look for the HLND format or the Anon creds format, whereas conversely, a different agent might just look for the W3C standard because it's a bigger standard, more widely adopted, and all that. So you can only have maybe one preferred or one format that you're looking for, or you could conversely have or be supporting multiple formats. So you might want to be able to handle multiple things that are thrown at you, maybe in some sort of preference order. So regardless of that, ultimately the problem is not extracting the data structure from the attachment. The problem is what you're going to be doing with it and how it's going to get processed. So that's why I'm thinking that there's not even a need maybe for these somewhat complicated format traits, because what you're actually going to end up doing and what these traits are actually doing under the hood is you take a Anon creds, again, I know a credential handling implementation, let's say Anon creds, and you feed in, you could potentially feed in that attachment, or simply try to extract a type that's expected by that credential handling implementation and just pipe that in, and then it's going to get verified or proven or issued or processed or whatever. And then maybe if you need some sort of storing capabilities, you hear the wallet comes in, it's a different thing, and so on and so forth. So that's what I kind of wanted to get at. I'm not sure how much sense it makes because it's all over the place. I'm just trying to say that from a protocol perspective, the protocol doesn't really care about this. What I picture when I think about this protocol is that you provide your credential handling type, the interface, maybe a credex, for instance. You provide a wallet or whatever is going to be used to store that thing. And maybe these parameters could be configurable in some manner. I liked the idea that George had with the associated types for the input and whatnot. I don't know if that's necessarily something that must still be there, but it might, and that's fine if you ask me. But then the actual or the tougher part would be handled generically through the interfaces in whatever way is needed. And for instance, if you have your attachment and you could maybe pass in multiple credential handling implementations, or you could retry an operation of maybe extracting that credential based on different implementations that you're passing in. But ultimately, I don't think the protocol should care, or the state machine, or the functions associated to the protocol. I don't think they should care about what the format is. I think they should just work with the attachment as a data structure, and then the attachment gets decomposed or composed maybe as part of a separated thing outside. Yeah, so I was just saying that I think the protocol itself will only be working with attachments, and the attachments can be handled in generically through by the use of that credential handling implementation, which might have an associated type for, let's say, credential or presentation or whatever, and the way, like, the data structures that it's actually working with. Okay, I'm sorry, that took a long time, but...
No, that was good. Thanks for summarizing. I'll try to summarize how I understand it. It sounds almost like what I have with this, like the handler interface or the trait, and then the
the state machine, but you want to take that handler out of the state machine and it's sort of its own thing on the side. And then the state machine is sort of pretty trivial, pretty simple. It just takes in, you know, vex of attachments and constructs messages and, you know, checks thread IDs and that other trivial stuff. Is that what you're imagining?
Yeah, pretty much. I think it could be, you know, the abstraction that you use on top of, you know, all these combinations between the interfaces that are there, you know, the what right now we have as anon creds or the base anon creds trait and the wallet and whatnot. So it could perform the operations that are needed, but without actually caring about that format. Because, like I said, from my understanding of the protocol, it doesn't really care. And there's nothing, you know, virtually nothing preventing you from, let's say, your agent is sending me a message with an attachment in the anon creds format, and provided that I know you support it, or for any reason at all, I just send you a credential in a different format. If you support it, you're not even going to care about the fact that it's a different format. Ultimately, you care about the data that's contained there. The format is really just that, the format, which is a specification for how the data structure is supposed to look like, so that you know what you expect in your implementation when you're handling the data structure. But yeah, the state machine will become more trivial, I guess. And yeah, the heavier lifting would be shifted rather outside, or not necessarily outside, but in different components that would work in a more generic fashion. For instance, even the states right now, they are linked to that format, which I don't think it's necessarily a good thing. I'm not saying anyone would have a good reason to change format on the fly, but you know, for the sake of flexibility, and maybe not even that, just for the sake of design and architecture, I don't think that's necessarily a good thing. I think it tightly couples the protocol with the format in a way that, in my opinion, is not necessary.
Yeah. I think I agree. I think the con with the current design I have is that it forces you to stay in the same protocol or format family throughout the whole protocol. And it doesn't allow you to attach multiple different formats.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the con, but sort of the pro is that it's more convenient when everything's in one place or in one state machine, rather than the consumer having to, you know, sort of jump between this state machine and this other handler thing outside of it, if you get what I mean.
But I'm not trying to say that there would be additional work for the consumer of the library to do, but rather just that the design of the state machine and the operations and the arguments that would be passed in, you know, would just allow for things to work seamlessly without the consumer having to specify a format. So picture that you would have, I know, a constant on the base anon creds trait right now, and the constant would be, I don't know, credential format or whatever, credential issuance v2 protocol format, and it's going to have a static string with the exact type that, you know, you would find in the format, or maybe I saw there are some enums there, so it could essentially have that. It would basically maybe not necessarily piped on the base anon creds trait itself, but rather, I know, some utility function that takes a type implementing base anon creds, and it takes an attachment, and it's going to look in that attachment for a credential or a message that matches that specific format. And then it extracts it for you, deserializes it, whatever, and it provides you as an output an associated type of the base anon creds trait, which it doesn't have right now. Sorry, it doesn't have right now, but a guy can dream. So then you end up with that, let's say, unknown associated type. But given that that unknown associated type is in fact going to be used later on with the anon creds, the base anon creds trait, you know, it's going to be passed to one of these functions that, again, in an ideal world will be strong typed, and it's going to take the associated type as a parameter, as an argument, then you don't even care about the format. You just pass it in and that's it. And then your credential gets stored or whatever. And then maybe, I don't know, it gets serialized to some string or byte vector and stored in the wallet. So the type is either erased when you don't need it and you don't care about it, like it is with the wallet, because you're just ultimately going to store that and you don't care about what's in it. You just care about, storing the data. Not to mention that the wallet could be also passed in as an argument to the base anon creds trait functions, so that it wouldn't be contained within the data, within the type itself. And that's something I want to work on. But yeah, that's pretty much my idea, that through this coupling of the format with, again, I'm just going to say anon creds implementation, credential handling implementation, if you will, then you're not even going to need to know the format in the protocol implementation. You just pass that on and the implementation will handle it. And if the format, I don't know, if a specific format is not matched, then again, you could throw out a particular error, or you could try again maybe with a different anon creds, you know, or credential handling implementation. So let's say you want to be able to support both credits, and so HL-Indy and anon creds credentials, you could have sort of a trial and error kind of thing of trying Indy and then trying anon creds. If the Indy message extraction from the attachment fails, or you could just do a lookup first based on the formats and decide on that. You know, it's not like you have to attempt to deserialize the message and convert it from base64 and then get an error and realize, yeah, this is not right. You have the formats attached there, so you can just use that and decide based on preference what you're going to be calling up next, and maybe the implementation that you're going to be using to process that credential. I don't know, does this make any sense?
I think it's making sense. One thing that maybe I'm mishearing, but I don't think the base and non-creds trait could really be applied to these W3C credentials. Sort of the processes that you go through with W3C creds is completely different to what you do within a non-cred credential. I'm not sure if that's what you were saying, that it could be used.
Yeah, no, but that's why I'm saying that the interface would have to be redesigned to basically accommodate that too. It's not right now. I believe that these interfaces were born as part of introducing other components. And when, for instance, you want to introduce credex, because we had VDR tools, the things are mostly the same. Even in anon creds versus credex, the implementation is mostly the same. You know, on a general level, there are the revocation part is different. But in terms of, an end user that might just be a holder / prover, they're virtually the same. But then that's the thing. The trait in its current state right now is obviously designed to just accommodate that. But on a broader perspective, you might want to have an interface that will be implementable for anon creds and maybe W3C, in a way that would make this processing more uniform.
Right. Would you say that the current traits that I implemented as part of this PR were along that line? Because I sort of made them with the intention of them working with the non creds or with W3C.
I guess so. I don't know. The thing is that I don't really know, like, precisely how W3C is supposed to work, or the exact differences in terms of processing that are gonna come out. And also when you consider Onocrats v2, for instance, Onocrats v2, I don't know if you've managed to see the specification, but it's going to introduce something that is not compatible with even Onocrats v1, not to mention Credex. But they're going to basically introduce some revocation handles that you as a holder have. And they have this thing that when an issuer will revoke a credential, not necessarily yours, the accumulator, you know, gets updated and sent to the ledger, updated on the ledger too. But at that point, the your handle, like for all the holders, become invalid, and you have to request a new one from the issuer. So this is a completely new dynamic that's not even present, you know, right now, but allegedly it would be present in Onocrats v2. So I don't even know if these things can actually be, if an interface can be designed to support all of these things, or to what extent can it support everything from these different specifications. But maybe that's also one reason why I would honestly just focus on the indie credentials and Onocreds v1, maybe, and wait a bit for the ecosystem to grow more mature before deciding on, okay, you know what, we need to scratch that Onocreds trait implementation, and we need to design something that's going to be able to support all these verifiable credentials implementations and all the mechanisms used to verify them and issue them and whatnot, because things are not necessarily clear for me on what's actually going to last in the long run. Like Onocreds v1. Onocreds v1 is basically becoming obsolete with Onocreds v2 coming out. Or maybe not. Maybe Onocreds v2 will actually turn out to be a mistake. Maybe specifically because of these revocation handles that change the dynamic. I don't know. But yeah. Just putting it out there. These are my two cents about it. And the traits you design, they're okay, but I just feel like they're very, very complex. And I feel like the complexity is not necessarily warranted there in the issuance v2 protocol as much as it is warranted in the credential handling or what we currently have as base Onocreds. I think that's what would ultimately need to be redesigned to support, let's say, W3C verifiable credentials as well as Onocreds verifiable credentials. But to that, I don't have an answer. I don't know exactly how that should look like. It might be possible, maybe. I don't think it would necessarily be impossible, but with all these things, it boils down to how big of an effort it's going to be to actually support all of these things. And whether it's worth.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm wondering if it's worth doing it at this time, trying to generalize all these formats into a single
trait. I don't think so.
Yeah. So if not, would you say it's the state machines? Say we make this new implementation, the state machines are pretty trivial. They just, you know, take in attachments and create the message and track thread IDs, and you know they have helper functions for telling consumers of those state machines what formats they've been given, and then the consumer can decide, you know, oh, it has these three, but I want to use the non-creds format. I know how to do that. And then, you know, they use their base non-creds implementation, whatever that is, to handle that. And, you know, if it's W3C, then they can go off and handle that another way and create, you know, the attachment to reply and shove it back into the state machine. I guess it makes it more complicated for the consumer, but it doesn't put us into a corner.
Well, I don't even think these operations are necessarily related to the state machine. It's just a matter of you received your message, and maybe in fact, the format thing, like extracting the formats out of these messages They could just be, you know, maybe some methods on the messages themselves. I'm not necessarily that much of a strong believer in, I don't think that data layer is supposed to be extremely dumb and only have data structures and that's it. I firmly believe there could be useful utilities here and there. And perhaps this is a good example of it. You know, you have your message, I know, from Credential Issuance V2, and you have your attachments there. So you could perhaps have a sneak peek at the attachment, and the attachment could expose some methods to provide you with the formats that it contains, right? Where it's actually an array of attachments, I believe. So you could get the formats out of the message and map them to the attachments that you need. And then with the attachment, you know, the attachment it had, knowing the format that it has, you could take that and pipe it in into the state machine, and just that's maybe one operation where you would put these things into the state machine. And you could have maybe, I guess it's also about the how far are you willing to go with the abstraction. You could have you know, more flexibility by having methods that, let's say, work this way. And, you know, you provide the attachment and the based on Oncred's implementation, and the magic is going to happen under the hood. Or you could have maybe a more extensive method where you just provide the message and the Oncred's implementation, and you just say, you know what, I have this implementation of based on Oncred's trait. It's for Credex. It's going to look for the HLND attachment format. If it finds it, it's going to process it. If it doesn't, tough luck, you throw out an error. So you could technically also do that, not making consumers have to manually deal with the formatting thing themselves. As a, I don't know, kind of a shortcut, you know, throughout the code. But if you want to if you want to deal with that, you might have to dive a bit deeper. Which I think you ultimately have to do as well, right? Even with these traits that are there right now, you have to provide them as arguments. So you still have to basically decide what format do you want to get out of that message, based, again, probably on your preference or business logic or business decisions. I don't necessarily see it as being very different from that.
Yeah, I think I'm following. Yeah, I don't know. I'm thinking maybe I could just try reuse those traits I have, but decouple them from the state machine a bit, because they kind of do what you're describing there, where you shove it in the message or the attachment, and you tell what to do.
What I would do.
Sorry.
Maybe an idea to explore. This is just what I, you know, instinctively would do. I would create some sort of a super trait for the base on creds trait that, you know, you can implement for stuff that implements base on creds, and it would provide these extensions that are currently not in the base on creds trait because it would have to be redesigned. You know, like the associated type for credential, for presentation, the format is maybe a constant string. And you could take in arguments that implement the super trait that you design, you know, and then it would basically work in this manner that I was describing, with automating, since it has all the pieces of the puzzles, but in a generic fashion. You can automate the extraction of the message from the attachment, passing that to the OnCreds implementation, and doing whatever you need to do with it. It could be an idea. I'm not saying it will necessarily work. I'm obviously, when you start implementing stuff, things might not be as easy as they seem. But that's what I would try to do, and I think that should be flexible enough without compromising the protocol implementation necessarily. You don't have to do this. I'm just putting it out there. It's an idea. If you don't think it's good, don't. No pressure.
Yep. No, gotcha.
And maybe just to point out, I guess the ultimate goal of this would be to eventually merge these two things, you know, the base on credit trait with the super trait, to kind of have just one singular thing where the base on credit trait is strongly typed with in terms of function arguments, and it would have some associated types based on the types that it works with, because all of these come from the implementation that you're using, right? Credex has its own types, and AnonCreds has its own types, and so on.
Yeah, no, I get where you're coming from. That's sort of, if it is possible to generalize these different credential formats, it's just the one thing I worry about that might not be possible or reasonable or pretty.
Well, one additional thing, and this was Patrick's idea a while ago regarding that AnonCreds trait, is perhaps splitting it on domains. So you would have a trait for an issuer and one for a holder slash prover and one for a verifier, basically one per different entity that you could act as in all these protocols. And that might actually make it simpler in some regards, I think, because you wouldn't any longer have to deal with all the state that comes with performing the responsibilities of a certain actor. You only have to mind your own business. So ultimately, how different can credential verification be between W3C and Aries, for instance? I'm sure there are differences, but especially with smaller things like this, you might be able to accommodate differences easier, because it's easier to keep track of what that entity is doing.
I'll chip in my 50 cents into your great discussion so far, guys. I'm like kind of split up on like countering ideas. I guess I definitely, in some way, I'm on board with the idea basically of making, as you George described, basically making the state machine itself kind of dumb and externalizing this processing and the particular credential details, implementations elsewhere. And also it's kind of matching up, one of my I'm not sure how to call it, important ideas I expressed in my code review, was this protocol versus artifacts around here, where I'm kind of wondering about the fact whether that currently it tends to be that the protocol in a complete state also is sort of becomes kind of an API for the underlying artifact, for a bit, the holder credential or the issuer credential, where in a V1 implementation you typically store the issuer credentials and then those state machines, and then when you want to actually revoke some credential, you would load up the state machine, and the state machine contains the credential ID, and then you would revoke those. But the APIs for the revocation are on those state machines in complete state. So it's kind of serving two purposes at once. One thing is to get that drive that protocol to completion. And once it's in a complete state, it kind of becomes this artifact, this API controller for that underlying artifact, the credential which was issued. So point being here, I was wondering if the protocols, if the state machines should really just serve for that conversation to happen, and then, you know, kind of on prevent the user of ArrayVCX to misuse these protocols as kind of controllers for the final artifact. I was making the same case for a connection, where in a connection implementation currently it's a bit different in the exchange, but in connection protocol, basically, you know, the protocol is really just to exchange the IDs, but currently the connection state machines is actually having another role, because once the connection protocol is complete, then you're using the state machine in complete state as a API for sending messages. Whereas it might make sense to kind of decouple these things and have connection state machines to accommodate the protocol itself, and then an output of that being is some sort of DITCOM channel, a set of DID plus keys. And why am I even saying this? Well, I wanted to raise attention to this in regard to all the discussion going on. And it, I guess it kind of also fits into that idea of externalizing, handling these credentials, where, you know, on a protocol level, really just like the RFC itself, you just deal with them as a attachment, and you don't really care. And then you kind of externalize these underlying artifacts elsewhere, and you don't necessarily have to track, keep storing these state machines after the issuance, you know, has been completed. Like, perhaps that should really be externalized. At the same time, I'm thinking, you know, I'm looking at this code, for example, looking at the existing issuer protocol, and what that state machine is doing. I mean, in general, these state machines, the purpose of the state machines, after all our previous discussions, was kind of boiled down to the fact that what the state machines helps us to do is to remember the pieces of the data you will need in subsequent steps in a protocol to construct your replies. And so, for example, once we construct and send credential offer as a issuer, we store a bunch of data here, which we probably, I believe, need in a next state, because after you send the offer, you are expecting credential request in, you know, Anoncrets world. And let me quickly look at the processing logic here. So when you receive build credential offer and request, somewhere must be receiving request processing. So when you receive request, what do we do? So thread verification that might be externalized, but the point being here, we construct a new state where we just propagate the data. So it technically could be just the same state, but then after we do this, we call build credential, and there we are reusing this whole bunch of data, which is specific for Anoncrets, to actually continue the protocol. And the state machine is kind of aware, you know, is storing the tails file thing, the revocation registry ID. It remembers this data, so you would be able to build a credential in the next step. I don't have a clear conclusion here, but I'm just wondering whether or whether not the state machine should be aware or should not be aware of the underlying credential type, or whether that can be solved through some associated types. I don't have a clear point to make. Just a bit of a brain dump following all the things you guys said, and wondering if what I'm saying might raise any sparks in your minds, even though I don't have a clear conclusion or a clear point.
Yeah, I think it makes sense. I was trying to use the associated types to keep format specific data that needs to be maintained. I was trying to do that with associated types. For instance, remembering what the revocation registry is, or the cred rev ID, whatever it's called, and other things like in a non-creds, you have to remember the request metadata as a holder when you store the credential. So you have to like remember that data across the state machine, or across the states. So that's what I was trying to do. I'm not sure how with Bogdan's idea of the VC holder trait or that generalization, how it could be made to sort of keep track of that state there for the user, or how we'd keep track of that state without coupling the state machine to anything. So you made me more confused, actually.
The thing which kind of came up to my mind now is I'm wondering if we could actually use wallet for storing. So instead of never mind, I don't think I have a clear case. Bogdan, you unmuted for yourself for a short moment. I think you want to add something.
Yeah, merely that I personally see the messages as sufficient for keeping track of state, or even if they're insufficient, if you have to keep track of some stuff for like throughout a protocol, keeping track of some initial information so that you can continue later on in the next steps, I think that the processing of the messages should actually be different than keeping track of states, which is why I don't necessarily see, they describe them as state machines, but I don't necessarily see these protocols as state machines. They're really a series of steps for just passing messages back and forth. That essentially just describe, like the thing with the state machine is just to keep track of the state where you were in so that you know what to expect next. If I send you a connection request, then I'm expecting a connection response back. And if you send something else from the protocol, then, on that specific thread or messaging, messaging thread, then I'm just going to ignore it or throw you an error or whatever. But the actual processing of the message, especially in terms of, verifying a credential or stuff like that, that doesn't necessarily have that much to do with the state per se. I'm not sure how much sense I'm making, but the transition is effectively dictated by where we were, so what message you just received as part of a protocol, And then transition is basically the generation of a new message, which we're going to send. And it just revolves around that idea. I guess the point I'm trying to make is it's more, I don't know, I see this a bit more, I see this more as being just some sort of state tracking rather than the requirement of having an actual state machine, you know, with well-defined transitions and whatnot, and what happens in it, and all these things. I just think the messages, you know, and the keeping track of the state is in fact sufficient for that. They're basically implicit, you know. I see the state machines here as being implicit. It's not necessarily, I don't know, the sequence of steps is very well defined, whereas it's not like you're building a vending machine and you can put in whatever coin you have inside and you have to keep track of where you are because you can receive an arbitrary combination of coins until you reach the amount that your product is priced at. I can sense how I lost all of you guys. That's fine. it was just a comment, and don't necessarily take it into consideration.
All right, guys. It's been a long call, a lot longer than anticipated. Perhaps ideas raised and question marks. I think this is not like solved yet out yet. So I don't know. I guess let's give it a day to like process our thoughts and some of those ideas which came up. Perhaps try to explore something. I would like to do that myself as well, and kind of catch up on the discussion. But I mean, it's already pretty cool, George. You have tested this with Akapai, right? So technically, it works. It's just like this is a good opportunity for. I mean, I guess like yeah. The implementation here will like set up the precedent for the next implementations, which likely want to support these multiple protocols and for both issuance and verification. It's kind of a opportunity to do things without considering some like you know, existing infrastructure build on top of this stuff because there's none yet. So yeah, let's just give it some bit time and think about it and see what kind of conclusions I'm gonna come up with.
Yeah, I have sort of one idea I might draft up in the next day and propose to you guys. So. Stay tuned. But yeah, thanks for the discussion.
All right. Thank you all for patience and thank you for ideas and discussion. Have a nice day and the rest of the week as well. Cheers.
Cool. Thanks, guys.
Have a good one. Bye-bye.
See you.